Now, let me ask you a question this morning as we jump into the message and look at God's Word together. Have you ever discovered in life that there's some things that are great in theory, but then when you put them into practice, they're a lot harder? Have you ever discovered that? Have you come to that conclusion that, you know, you got this ideal, you have this vision of how it ought to be, you just have this expectation of how things ought to come out, and yet when it happens, when you work at it, it's just not quite as easy as you thought it was. We have this ideal picture in our mind, and yet reality can be a lot harder, can be a lot different. I have a phrase I developed a number of years ago about this, and it just simply says this: life wouldn't be so hard if I didn't think it ought to be so easy. Think about that. Life wouldn't be so hard if I didn't think it ought to be so easy and everything work out. Let me give you an example. It's kind of like shopping. It might be going to do Christmas shopping. It might be doing birthday shopping. And you go to the store, and maybe you're buying a present for your spouse or for your kids. You're buying a present for somebody special. And you get this box, and you buy this box, and you get home, and the box says on it these words: some assembly required. I mean, you had this idea of what it would be like. You had this idea of what it would look like, and you were just so excited about it. And then when you got into the project, the ideal came face to face with reality. And it didn't quite work out the way you thought it ought to work out. I think of romance for a moment. We think of, oh, wow, the limousine, the fancy restaurant, the amazing meal, the personal hygiene that goes into it, the clothes and the decor, just the setting, the mood, and how wonderful it is. And then that's the ideal. Then you think of the reality of it. If you're young, it's kind of like, well, you know, it's the big pimple right there in the middle of your forehead, or it's, do I have enough money to do this, or where are we going to go, and what are we going to do after the show, or after McDonald's, and then you try to get it off. Or if you're married, and you, well, now we got to find a sitter, now we got to figure out who will even put up with our kids for a couple of hours while we get away, and can we afford that, and then where are we going to eat? But I don't want to eat there, but I thought you said we'd go anywhere, Well, just wherever you want to go, but I don't want to go there. And so we do all of that, right? And all of a sudden, what was going to be a romantic evening together just becomes one more exercise in futility. This is the ideal versus the real. You know, think about parenthood. This past Friday, we had Michelle Duggar come and speak for MOPS, and we had over 100 women gathered here and all of their kids throughout the building. Had 22 people working with those kids, and it was a phenomenal time. She's an amazing woman, mother of 20 children. How many women would say you feel blessed of God right now? I mean, 20 children. And yet, when you look at their kids, they're so well-behaved. They all play instruments. I mean, they're models of community. She had a couple with them on Friday, and you just think, oh, how come my kid can't be like that? And they're so amazing. And then they've written all these books about growing up Duggar and how to raise your kids, and she makes it look so easy. I mean, even to have your own reality TV show. You know what I mean? You know, like they put your life maybe next to Breaking Bad, where they put hers, you know, next to Highway to Heaven. And it's just kind of like, wow, how do you do that? And then the reality, you know, when you think of your family, it may be more like The Simpsons or somebody like that. Reality. The ideal, you know, when we felt God and we sense God and we follow God's leading and even moving here and building this building and doing ministry and reaching out to people, wow, the idea, the vision, the possibilities, and then all of a sudden the bills start coming due and the reality hits. And my goal is that we'd have the building paid off in 5 years, and that was, that was 5 years ago, and we're not there yet. Reality, life happens, it costs money, it takes time, people don't have those kind of finances all the time. And so you think, well, we got an ideal, but then reality hits. You know, in life, when the ideal, you got this ideal, and then when you're faced with the real, it's really easy to become cynical, isn't it? It's really easy to, especially when that real pops that ideal button, a balloon, so many times. Someone said, idealism is what precedes experience, and cynicism is what follows. There's a lot of truth in that. As someone said, a cynic is a man who, when he smells flowers, he looks for a coffin. Do you know anybody like that? Or Peggy Noonan is a well-known author today in our society, and she said it this way, cynicism is not realistic and tough. It's unrealistic and kind of cowardly because it means you don't have to try. That's a challenge, isn't it? Now, you don't have to be a cynic. There's a better way, and it's this. You can balance the ideal and the real together. You can hold on to the ideal while you are living by faith and holding on as you experience the real. We're going to look at the book of Acts today, Acts chapter 16. And if you have your Bible, and I hope you do, I invite you to turn over there. And there are several realities in this chapter and really all through the book of Acts where we see this contrast between here's the ideal and then here's the real deal. And we see the importance of balancing the two together, that God has a purpose and a plan, and sometimes it doesn't work out exactly that way at first, and then it comes around. Now, last week, I shared with you about Philippians chapter 2, and we looked at the whole issue of unity in the church. We talked about how important it is that the Bible compels us to unify, to be united in spirit in the bond of peace. And we saw that the scripture says, make every effort to keep the spirit of unity in the bond of peace, that you've got to fight for it, you've got to struggle for it, you've got to do all that you can to achieve it and hang on to it. Why? Because unity is so under attack. Jesus prayed that high priestly prayer in John chapter 17, and he said to God the Father, he says, may my disciples, may those who follow me now and forever, may they be brought into complete unity to let the world know that you have sent me and have loved me or loved them even as you have loved me. You know, you look at sometimes the church is anything but a picture of unity, isn't it? The Harmony Church, and then down the street you have the New Harmony Church from the people that got upset in the Harmony Church, and they go be in the New Harmony Church. It's like the guy, you've all heard the story of the guy on the desert island, and when he was rescued, they found two buildings there and then a little hut, and they say, well, what's that hut? Well, that's where I live. Well, what are the two buildings? Well, that's my church I go to. Well, what's the other one? Well, that's the church I used to go to until the church split. And so it's just this real and this ideal of what we experience. And the scripture talks about how we need to fight for unity. We need to maintain unity. And the real is that unity is going to come under attack, that God has a plan for unity, but it's going to come under attack. And so in Acts chapter 16, we see some other examples or illustrations of what it means to have this balance between what is ideal and what is real. Here's the first one. The ideal is this, is that God has a clear path for your life. God has a purpose. God has a plan. God has a very clear path. God has a plan for your life, and it's wonderful. I mean, who doesn't love Jeremiah chapter 29? What an amazing verse. Probably one of my favorite verses underlined in my Bible. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. That gets you excited, doesn't it? God knows where we are. He's got plans for us, and we can celebrate that. Not to hurt us, but to bless us. A hope and a future. And then Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, beautiful verse where it says, we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. It's saying even before we were born, even before you were conceived, God had a purpose and a plan for your life. I mean, that's why it's so significant when we talk about life, when we talk about choosing life, when we talk about the unborn, that no one's a mistake. Nobody's an accident. even what we might call illegitimate. They're no illegitimate children, they're illegitimate parents. But every child's a precious gift of God. Every child is wanted by God, and somebody wants that child. And so that's the reason we don't support abortion. We don't support that type of embryonic cell research because of the effect that it has on life. That's our ideal. That's our belief. We believe in that. And then the reality comes along. You know, my personality is that when I think of God as a plan and a purpose, I'm going like, well, let's do it then. You know, let's get this thing going. Let's get this thing accomplished. Let's go for it. God, lay it out because I'm ready to go. And then all of a sudden reality hits. And the reality often, the real deal is sometimes God's path is found through a series of closed doors. Sometimes we're going headlong and we're going straight forward and we hit a brick wall or the door slams closed. Anybody have a testimony on that? Imagine we can spend the next several weeks and months and maybe even years just giving personal examples of hitting closed doors. You read the story of Paul in the book of Acts chapter 16, and it seems as though Paul was on his way somewhere. He was always going someplace. He always had a mission to accomplish. He had people to share with and preach to, and the gospel was to go forward. And he was so excited about it, but it seems like almost at every corner, every turn, he hits a brick wall, he hits a closed door, that something stops him and gets in his way. For the Apostle Paul, his greatest goal was to go to Rome. He wanted to preach to the Romans, the seat of authority for the Roman Empire. He wanted to proclaim the good news of Christ, and he got so close, and yet time and time again, he was prevented from going until the end part of his life. And then even when he went, at that time, he was in prison. So it wasn't the trip that he thought it would be. Sometimes God's path is found through a series of closed doors. And sometimes that real thing is to realize that yes, God has a plan for us, God has a purpose for us, but often that purpose and plan is found in that closed door. Look at Acts chapter 16. Paul and Barnabas, we find in the end of Acts chapter 15, have had an argument, and they've split over John Mark. And there's been a conflict there, and that gets worked out later, and we'll talk about that in a future message. And now if Paul is traveling with Silas, and they've picked up Timothy, who becomes Paul's protege. He writes these books later in his writings to Timothy, Timothy 1, Timothy 2. And he joins them on this trip, and verse 6 says this: "Now Paul and Silas traveled through the area of Phrygia and Galatia because the Holy Spirit had prevented them from preaching the word in the province of Asia at that time. Then coming to the borders of Mysia, they headed north for the province of Bithynia. But again, the Spirit of Jesus did not let them go there." Paul wants to go to Asia. Paul wants to go there and preach the gospel. But time and time again, he hits these closed doors. What's in Asia? What's near Bithynia? It's the city of Ephesus, this major city of commerce, this central hub of travel and trade. It's this local place. It's this major city of just excitement, and people are coming left and right. And he says, if I could just go to Ephesus and preach, the gospel could go forward. And he was prevented time and time ago. Twice the Spirit keeps him from going there. So what do you do when a door closes in your life? What do you do when you're saying, well, God, I've trusted in you, I'm following you, and I want what you want, and you start going that direction, and yet you hit a brick wall. You hit a closed door. And the truth is, you can find God's guidance in a closed door as much as you can an open door. So what do you do? Let me give you three things that I believe the Scripture tells us that we are to do. First is this: make sure the door is closed. I mean, it's pretty simple, isn't it? You believe God is leading you a certain direction, the Word tells you a certain thing, and you're saying, God, that's what I need to do, and yet you hit a closed door. Make sure the door is closed. It might be just a rusty hinge that needs oiling. It might be just a something that takes a little bit of effort. I know a lot of people, some of you, some teenagers have grown up in the church, and some of my own family, that when they went to get their driver's license, they actually failed the written test 2 or 3 times. And I know others who, when they went to get their driver's license, they passed the written test, but then they failed the driving part 2 or 3 times. And, you know, wouldn't it be so easy to say, well, you know, I guess it's God's will that I don't get a driver's license. I'm just going to close the door on that. I'm just not going to do that. If I didn't pass the test the first time, I'm not going to do that. There's no way we do that, is there? We go, I'm going to go back and study. I'm going to take that test again because I'm going to push that door open. I'm going to make sure that door's not closed. I can do this thing. And we go forward. We put our shoulder to it. And we push the door open a little bit. I remember when I first was called to ministry, and the call that I had was to work with teenagers. And so I was a youth pastor, and I was loving it, and we were having all kinds of outreach and ministries, and lives were being touched and changed. And in the height of what I was doing, my pastor resigns to become a district superintendent. Well, all of a sudden, what happens in the Church of the Nazarene, if the senior pastor, the lead pastor, resigns, then all the staff have to resign, and the church board have to rehire him for the interim. And then when a new pastor comes, he decides if the staff will stay or not. And he approves that or disapproves it. And so I'm in this quandary. Things are going well. What do I do? And my pastor leaves. And I say, well, maybe God, you have a different plan for me. So we move to Kansas City. I go to seminary. And I think, well, I'll get a youth pastor position up here. But nothing opened up. I became a worship pastor, but that wasn't what my calling was. And then I started working for the Nazarene headquarters and the youth ministry department, and that was wonderful because I was still involved in youth ministry, but it wasn't that hands-on, that life-touching life ministry that I really wanted. Well, I could have easily said, well, door's closed. I guess God has a different plan. I guess I'll forget that. But I kept pushing. I kept following through. I kept staying the course and realizing God didn't have a closed door. He just had a different door for me to go through. He had a different way of me. And then after a few years, God began to change my heart, and I began to see that my calling was beyond just youth ministry, that He called me to be a lead pastor. And so He led me in that direction. You know, sometimes you just need to back up the truck, and you need to gun it and go up the hill again. You don't just leave it in the ditch. And, you know, I've said so many times to God, God, if this isn't your will, close the door. I mean, nail that thing shut. Make it so hard, make it so difficult, I can't go through, because until you give me a different direction, I'm going to keep going the direction you've led me in. I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to give up until you go and lead me to a different direction. So make sure the door is closed. Second thing I believe we see in this passage and we learn is we need to thank God for the closed door. That in the midst of a difficult time, in the midst of when things are not seeming to work out, rather than crying and over missed opportunities of what could have been, and how many times we do that, and I do that, you do, and we struggle, and there's so many people struggle there. Instead of crying about missed opportunities, thank God for where you are. It may be just one less thing that you had to deal with because that door was closed. You may have had one less problem to deal with. And so you say, thank God, because you've watched over me and protected me. But you keep doing what you can do. Look at what Paul does in Acts 16, verse 8. It says, so instead, they went on through Mysia to the seaport of Troas. So instead. You ought to circle that phrase. You ought to circle that those two words together. So instead. So there's a different plan. They didn't just give up. So instead of what? So instead of complaining and whining and moaning over the circumstances, they go a different direction. They just continue to do what they were doing. And verse 8 says, they went on. They went on. They didn't stop. They didn't allow it to knock the wind out of them and keep them from moving forward. And you know, later we find out when we read about Paul that he was put in prison several times. And I wonder, how many of you know that prison is a closed door? I mean, you know that, right? Prison's a closed door. And it would be so easy for Paul to say, but God, you've called me to minister to people. You've called me to be a missionary and to go out into the world. And what do I do now? I'm just going to moan and complain, and I'm going to be upset, and I'm just going to be fretful, and I'm going to just go, woe is me. But instead, Paul goes, you know, God, what do you want me to do here? I'm here. I'm stuck here. I can't go anywhere. The door's closed. I got an officer or a soldier chained to me. I think I'll write a letter. I think I'll send a letter to the churches that I've started and been at and ministered to and just encourage them and share the Word of God with them. And the Holy Spirit begins to inspire Paul. And Paul sits down and writes a letter to the Corinthians. And he writes Philippians and Ephesians and Colossians from prison. He writes Galatians. He writes these letters and he sends these letters out, and these letters were read to the church. And these letters were passed on so many times to so many churches that over just a few short years, they became known as sacred writings along with other sacred writings and were just canonized right into the Bible that we have today. Because people realized this was God speaking. And I wonder how many less books we'd have in the Bible if Paul didn't get a closed door. And so we can, when difficulties happen and challenges happen, there's two ways of looking at it. We go, oh God, why is this happening to me? Or say, God, what do you want me to do through this? What do you want to do in me, and what do you want to do through me? God, you have something going on here. And instead of complaining, they went on. A few years back, I had a very good friend of mine. He had turned 50, and he was so frustrated because his life hadn't turned out the way he wanted it. And it seemed like every time he started something, he got a closed door. And his dream of what he wanted to do, it just seemed like nobody wanted him to do it. And so we began to talk, and I just began to listen to him. And I said, well, what is it that you really wanted to do? He said, I just want to teach people. I just want to pour into somebody's life. And as he began to talk, he says, you know, I've always kind of wanted to be a teacher. But I'm 50 years old. If I go back to school, it's going to take me 4 or 5 years to get my teaching certificate, my teaching degree. And then I'm going to be 4 or 5 years older than where I am now. And I'm only going to have a few years left to do what I want to do. And I don't know why I asked it. I asked this question. Well, if you don't go to school and don't go back to take education classes and get your teaching certificate, in 4 or 5 years, where are you going to be? And the light came on in his head and mine that he's going to be in the same place that he was. Well, he went back to school and he paid the price and he fought through it. And you know, being a little bit older, you'd know a little bit more kind of how to study and how to think. And he made A's in all of his classes and graduated with honor and got a teaching job. And he's been doing it now for about 5 years. And he said to me not too long ago, he says, you know, this is the best thing I've ever done in my life. And to think I only have about 5, 6 more years of supposedly before I'm supposed to retire, but I'm doing exactly what I'm supposed to do. I was trying to think this through, that maybe today is the yesterday that you are afraid to miss tomorrow. That so many times we think about, oh, what could have been and should have been, and if this would have only happened, and yet, if we keep staying there, where are we going to be in 2 years or 3 years or 5 years or 10 years? We're going to be in the same place we are now. But if we say, God, what do you want to do in me and through me? So don't cry over closed doors. Make the most of those doors. Make sure they're closed. Thank God for them. And then keep doing what God has directed you to do. Because closed doors are just an opportunity for God to do the next thing in your life and in my life. I deal with this in the church all the time as we talk about, well, we need somebody to teach college age. We need some people to help minister to our early childhood kids. We try to do at our church, we do something different from most churches, is we try to have team teaching, where a teacher will teach children or teenagers for a month, and then they'll switch off with somebody else for a month. And what we've discovered is that keeps them from being burned out. It adds just a great more variety and more mentors pouring into the life of our kids and our teenagers. But it enables us to minister in a greater way to those people, and it keeps our adults connected with other adults. It's kind of hard sometimes to go to a class for a month and then switch out, and yet the blessings are so amazing. And the whole issue is that God has a plan for us, and our job so many times is it seems like, well, we can't get anybody to do this, and we can't get anybody to do this. And I sense the Holy Spirit continually have to remind me, Alan, I've put every resource you need, every resource the local church needs, every resource this ministry needs at your disposal to be there when it's needed. And so I just have to step back and trust God. Okay, God, you don't want us to do that right now. You want us to go a different direction. But then sometimes I have to push through. Our staff has to push through. You have to push through. That closed doors are just an opportunity for God to do the next thing. The third thing is this. Not only does sometimes doors are closed and sometimes, you know, we need to push and we need to thank God, but also expect God to open another door. Expect God to open up another possibility, another direction. Look at Acts chapter 16, verse 9. That night, Paul had a vision. He saw a man from Macedonia in the corner of Greece pleading with him, "Come over here and help us." So we decided to leave for Macedonia at once, for we could only conclude, listen to that, we could only conclude that God was calling us to preach the good news there. Paul wanted to go to Rome, Paul wanted to go to Ephesus, but God had an alternate route. Just because the path isn't straight doesn't mean that God doesn't have a plan. Just because it may be difficult and challenging, you remember I said, just because, you know, life wouldn't be so hard if I didn't think it would be so easy. Sometimes God even takes the paths that are crooked and messed up and weaves them into his will. Has anybody ever heard of Dave Ramsey? You ever heard of Dave Ramsey, who is the author and the overseer of Financial Peace University? You know, we look at him and we go, well, this is how you handle your money. This is how you cut up your credit cards. This is how you create cash envelopes. And we teach that class, and it's a phenomenal class. But do you know the story of Dave Ramsey? Do you know where he was riding high at one time, and he was this big property guy and a real estate man, and he was in all kinds of investments, and the bottom fell out, and he lost everything, and he went bankrupt, lost his home, lost his cars, lost everything that he had, kept his wife and kept his kids. And God used that situation because it was in that point where he was at the deepest, lowest part of his life is when he turned to Christ. And when he turned to Christ, God used, all of a sudden, God took that mess and turned it into his message. And it was because he went through that dark time, that difficult time, that he's been able to help millions of people with what they've experienced and what they're going through. God turned that detour into his life's work. And you see, it's not just about getting off the path, and it's not about hitting closed doors. It's what do you do when you experience that? What do you do when you get there? There's another ideal that Paul talks about, or the book of Acts talks about here in Acts chapter 16, and it kind of goes a little bit different direction. And the ideal is this, is that God uses who I am to reach who I know. You know, God uses the people in my life, uses me to reach them. And our mission here at Rogers First is we believe that God has placed you and me where we are in the families, in the community, in the neighborhoods, in the work situations, in the jobs, to live incarnationally and missionally for the sake of Christ. Incarnationally means that we are to live out our faith in every aspect of our life, that we are blessed to be a blessing, that God has placed us where we are, around people to interact with them, to encourage them, to witness to them, that God wants to live through us to touch other lives that they can know Christ and be a part of his family. That's our mission. And ideally, that's what happens. I reach people I know, you reach people you know, I witness to people in my family, you witness to people in your family, and all of us, God takes the gifts and the abilities that we have, you and I have, and he uses them to reach people like us. I mean, what better person can reach people like me than me? And so I go and speak to them, and I can talk their language, and I can understand them, and I can minister to them. And we all know people that need Jesus. We all have family members. We all have friends. We all have work associates that need the Lord. And God calls us to respond to them in our family. And so our church does that in our teaching, in our preaching, in our reaching. The ideal is that God uses who I am to reach who I know. But then the real deal is this. Is that God loves to challenge our stereotypes and our prejudices when choosing who we are to minister to. Now, here's an interesting thing. You know that the Apostle Paul, those of you who have been around the church, have read the scripture, you know that the Apostle Paul was a rabbi. He was taught the Jewish law. He was raised up to be this leader, this teacher of the church, of the synagogue, not the church at that time. And the good, devout Jewish man had a prayer that they prayed every day. The Midrash, in the Talmud that was written kind of around the New Testament times, gives a prayer that the Jewish men would pray every day. And the prayer would simply be this. Every day, a good Jewish man, Paul the Apostle, prayed this every single day as he was growing up and up to maybe even up to this point. The prayer is this. God, thank you that you did not create me a woman. God, thank you that you did not create me a slave. And God, thank you that you did not create me a Gentile. Amen. And that was the prayer. And even Jews today, devout Jews, will pray that prayer. Thank you, God, you didn't create me a woman. Life at this time for a woman was extremely hard. Women were not considered even people in so much of society. They were more of possession, and they didn't have any power or any say. They didn't own property, and our country even experienced that years ago. But our times are different now, but in the time that this was written, thank God that I'm not powerless, he's saying. Thank God I'm not a slave. Thank God I'm not in bondage. You know, the Israelites were in bondage in Egypt for years. They had other people that were slaves all around them. There was the Romans that were oppressing them. Thank God that I wasn't created as a slave. And then thank God that I wasn't created as a Gentile. A Gentile is separate from God because the Israelites were God's chosen people. They had the promise. The Gentiles were left out of that promise. Thank God that I'm part of the family. I'm part of the team. I'm on the winning side, they're saying. And every morning he would pray that prayer. But who is it that God sent Paul to be the first converts and the first members of the church there where he was? Look at Acts chapter 16, verse 11. It talks about we boarded a boat at Troas and we sailed on and they go to Philippi. And they're there. It's this major city, this Roman colony, and they stayed there for several days. And in verse 13, it says this, on the Sabbath, we went away a little way outside the city to a riverbank where we thought people would be meeting for prayer. And we sit down to speak with some women who had gathered there. One of them was Lydia from Thyatira, a merchant of expensive purple cloth who worshiped God. As she listened to us, the Lord opened her heart, and she accepted what Paul was saying. She and her household were baptized. I mean, and so who's the very first convert in Philippi? It's a woman, and a wealthy one at that. And then the scripture goes on, look who's the second convert, verse 16. One day as we were going down to the place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit that enabled her to tell the future. She was demon-possessed. And it says she earned money for her masters by telling her fortunes. She followed Paul and the rest of us shouting, these men are the servants of the Most High God, and they've come to tell us how to be saved. This went on day after day until Paul got so exasperated. Wouldn't it be wonderful to have people following you around going, this guy knows Jesus, this girl knows the Lord, and they're going to tell us how to get right with God. And you go, I am so tired of you saying that. Let's just bow right now and repent of your sins and accept Jesus into your heart. Paul gets so exasperated that he turns and he says to the demon, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And instantly, it left her. Okay, the brand new church at Philippi has just started, and we have this woman, this rich lady, and now we have this slave girl who was demon-possessed. The only thing we lack now is a Gentile, right? Go on in verse 19. Her master's hopes of wealth were now shattered, so they grabbed Paul and Silas and dragged them before the authorities at the marketplace. The whole city is in uproar because of these Jews, they shouted, and a mob forms quickly. They strip Paul and Silas' clothes off and begin to beat them. They throw them into prison, and then it goes on in verse 24. It says, the jailer was ordered to make sure they didn't escape. So the jailer put them in the inner dungeon and clamped their feet in stocks. Around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. So instead of going, God, you sent us here, but look what they're doing to us. They're singing hymns to God. They're in prison. They've been beaten to an inch of their life. They're bloody, they're bruises, they're hurt, and they're singing praises to God. And other prisoners were listening. Suddenly, there was a massive earthquake, and the prison was shaken to its foundations. All the doors immediately flew open, and the chains of every prisoner fell off. Wow. The jailer woke up to see the prison doors wide open, and he assumed that the prisoners had escaped. So he drew his sword to kill himself. But Paul shouted to him, stop! Don't kill yourself! We are here! The jailer called for lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out and asked, sir, what must I do to be saved? They replied, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved along with everyone in your household. And they shared the word of the Lord with him and with all who lived in his household. And it goes on, then he and everyone in his household were immediately baptized. His entire household rejoiced because they all believed in God. Every day Paul would pray, God, thank you I'm not a woman. Thank you I'm not a slave. Thank you I'm not a Gentile. And God starts the church at Philippi with a woman, with a slave, and with a Gentile. Look at what Paul learned in Galatians 3:28. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor there is there male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Where do you think he learned that? You know, God showed him the difference between the ideal and the real. And he used to reach people that he knew, the scholarly, the educated, the Jewish, and then all of a sudden God closed some doors and opened up another door. And he began to reach people that we would say are unlikely. You think about that. God wants us to reach people that are like us, and yet the reality is that God loves to challenge our prejudices. God loves to challenge our stereotypes. And it got me thinking about me and us. Who are the unlikely people in your life? Who are the people that we tend to just walk by and write off? You think about, here's Lydia. Lydia was rich. You know, we have all kinds of ministries for the poor, and we talk about the poor, and we take compassionate ministries offerings, and we say, and we have a food pantry, and we help people every week. But the rich, I mean, we kind of lambast the rich, don't we? I mean, that's what Occupy Wall Street was all about. Those fat cats that have everything. You know, we need to redistribute the wealth and all this stuff. But what about those people? And how many times have we walked by people and written off people in our neighborhoods or because of where they live and what they drive and what they wear, how big their paycheck is? And we miss the whole point that they are lost and empty and going to hell without Jesus Christ. And then what about the broken? Here's this slave girl. You know, she's the second person that Paul encounters, and she gets freed from this demon. She's probably not a likely candidate to be part of the church. Can you imagine? You know, I want to work in the children's department. Is that okay? We going, oh, you know what kind of lifestyle she came out of? Do you know what she was involved in? Do you know the kind of person that she is? I don't think you'd make a good kids worker. You're just too broken. But I love stories of people who were broken and Jesus redeemed them and restored them. And the truth is, if we share our story, there are a lot of our stories of brokenness that God redeemed. What about the drug addict or the sex addict or the alcoholic or the person that's gone so far? But God breaks in and changes their heart and life. Who is it in your life that's broken that you've written off because they're too far gone? Or what about the jailer? This army vet, this blue-collar kind of guy. No great story, no big home or investment. He just works in a prison. And it's easy to miss the ordinary in our lives. The checkout person, the server, the person next to us on a plane, the custodian at work. That person just walks by us on the street. Just that ordinary person that we think, they're not like us. I don't know them. And yet God loves to take the ordinary, the broken. He loves to take the people who don't quite fit into our ideas and transform their lives. When you think about unlikely people in your life, who is it that you think of? Are they a closed door? Or is God saying, I have a different door, a new way for you to live and to be my disciple? Could it be that God wants to touch that person and change the world through them, and the only way that person's going to be touched is if you touch them through Christ? There's the ideal and there's the real. We have this picture of the way life ought to be, and sometimes it doesn't quite work out that way, probably most of the time. And yet our challenge is not just to turn around and walk off, but to say, God, what do you want to do here? And God, do it through me. God, use me. You know, I read a phrase this week. It says, God always seems to be asking the early church leaders to do things they didn't want to do. The Holy Spirit is always calling us to something bigger and better than we could accomplish in our own strength and resource. Resistance to the Spirit is resistance to the life-giving power of God, is choosing death over life. We choose to follow. Father, thank you today that you have your word that speaks to us in every aspect of our life. That we have this ideal, we have this image of how life ought to be and how we think people ought to be and how things should work out. And we know that you've given us those ideas many times. And yet reality comes along and it turns a twist and a different path and a closed door. Or give us that stamina and that strength that when we do encounter difficulties, that we wouldn't just acquiesce and walk away, but we would make sure that you've closed that door. Make sure that it's in your will that we stop doing what we're doing or we go a different direction. That we thank you for where we are. And even in those difficult circumstances, you can shape us and teach us and use us and provide for us, because it's often through the hard work and the effort and the stamina and the stability that your will is made known as we go through the fire. And Lord, that we believe and expect that when we encounter those difficult times, that you're going to provide a way. And so we keep our hearts open, walking by faith, trusting in your leadership, and seeking that direction from you. And as you open that, we'll be obedient to walk through, to continue this journey. That God, you would use us, not just to do what's easy and convenient for us, but that you would take our weaknesses, even our inabilities, and when we give them to you, you do more in us and through us, through them, than you often can do through the great talents that we have. Because we're dependent upon you. And right now, Lord, I know there's some that have been experiencing closed doors. It just seems like the door's been slammed in their face and they don't know what to do and where to go and how to do it. And they find themselves frustrated and upset and bitter and grieving and mourning and complaining. But God, would you turn that around, that we would see even that in those difficult times, you are at work. And that may be leading us to a different path, a different way, a different place, a different response. And as we meet people and as we interact with people in our life, that we would not write anybody off. But God, that we would see that the reality is that you love every person. And it doesn't matter how much we have or don't have. It doesn't matter what we can do or what we don't do. That everyone is still valuable in your sight. That you so love the world. That you gave your one and only Son, that whoever believes in Jesus should not perish but have everlasting life. And Father, today, perhaps there's some who would say, I haven't experienced that. And right now, would say, Jesus, forgive me. Come into my heart, that I can know you and live in you. And I could be like that jailer and experience new life. I can be like that slave girl and experience freedom. I can be like Lydia and have it all and yet not have anything. But find in you, I have the great treasure. Lord, here we are. What do you want to say to us? Where do you want to lead us? Who do you want us to reach out to and to minister to? I'm available, Lord. And I pray that each of us are to follow you.